अगर बात करते हैं तो वो मकबरे की बात करते हैं. तो what are we supposed to do? Are we going to live our entire lives around the tomb? So she said you need to, the exact word that she used was kida. कि there is a kida in your system.
से निकाले.
get this out. So I started writing a document which was like maybe around a 40-50 page thesis almost.
So just for yourself, not really
for anyone else. 40-50 pages to connect the dots. You see, because again, at the risk of going on, see how obsessed I am even now with this story. even at that time, there was another parallel story to this story, which was the visit in 1887 by a Russian explorer whose name was Nicholas Notovich. And Nicholas Notovich had visited a monastery in Ladakh. And while he was going there, he fell from his mule. So his leg broke. So he had to be taken to the monastery and he was there for the next 3 to 4 months while the leg repaired. So out there he was able to speak to the Lama. And the Lama showed him a document, an ancient parchment. And it talked about the story of a young boy called Isa, who came there at the age of 12 to learn under Buddhist masters. Now, I wanted to connect those two stories. So, I started writing this 40-page document, and eventually once I was done, you know, almost like a theory of everything, connect the dots. So, I did that and I gave it to my wife. I said, yaar, isko zara padh lo and tell me how it sounds. So, she read it and the next morning she said, Ashwin, congratulations. So I was very happy. I said, that means she's liked it. She said, no, congratulations, because you've discovered the cure for insomnia. Because now I know that if I just read 2 pages, I fall asleep.
Oh my God.
So that's how she is the one who suggested, ki isko kahani banao. Make it into
a
story.
From a documentary, yeah.
Yes. So, and then subsequently, if I really think about it, whether it was Chanakya's chant, whether it was the Krishna key, all of them, something happened where the story came to me. I didn't go out looking for them.
So tell me, from a documentary to a fiction, how was this dealt with from the publishing point of view? Did they make a lot of changes when you...
You see, I'll tell you, as far as the publishing industry goes, in any case, my relationship with them was one of mutual antagonism, because I went through that entire process of almost about, you can say, I finished writing this book in 2005, and then till 2008 the book was never published. So there were almost about 3 years where virtually every publisher on the planet had been approached and had turned it down for various reasons. So, as far as I was concerned, I had already made up my mind ki this may not see the light of the day with an ordinary publisher. And that is the reason why in 2007 I self-published it. Then in 2008...
Did you have an editor at that point, or did
yes,
you...
I had an editor. I engaged a professional editor to help me with that first book. But by the time Westland, which is currently my publisher, picked up the rights to the Rosabal line, they came back with a few suggestions. But I must say one thing about Westland, they didn't want to change the nature of the way the book was written. If you read the Rosabal line, and you have to be very courageous to read that book, because you're traveling 3,000 years one way or another way in the span of 3 pages. So it's a lot of people who've read the Rosabal line say that Ashwin Sanghi must have been consuming some sort of mind expanding substances when he wrote that book. You know, ye charas ganja kuch na kuch le raha hoga. So that is the approach which a lot of readers have. So if you are courageous enough to read that book, you'll realize that the fundamental character of that book has not been changed. So touch wood, in so many years I've not had a problem. Even when I was a nobody, I did not have a problem of publishers wanting to play around with what I had written.
But this is such an interesting
thing. It was because they couldn't make head or tail of what I had written.
But this is so interesting that whether you get turned down or no, it doesn't matter. I mean, how much can one know really whether what is, what will connect with the masses? No one knows. No one has the copyright or last authority on it, which is so
And not only that, Raksha, the truth is that rejection is a part of the entire process. In India, we have this concept called Agni Pariksha. Rejection is the Agni Pariksha. So, people ask me that when during those 3 years, when publishers were coming back to you and they were rejecting you, tumne kya kiya? How did you deal with it? Mm-hmm. So, in front of me, there was a board. You know, normal bulletin board hota hai na? So, there was a bulletin board in front of me, and uspe there were numbers. 12, 18, 30, 33. So, 12, for example, is the number of times that Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone was rejected. 18 is the number of times that Gone with the Wind was rejected. 30 is the time that Stephen King's first thriller, Carrie, was rejected. 33, and this should be close to your heart, 33 is the time that Chicken Soup for the Soul
was rejected. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, all of these numbers were there, and I said, yaar, if these people could be rejected so many times, then Ashwin Sanghi, tum kya cheez ho? And then over a period of time, I began to in fact see it the other way. I said, I'm going to be better than them because I've been rejected more than them. So, you have to find a way to sort of trick yourself.
That's fantastic, and for all the aspiring authors, I think this is something, it's a big takeaway, that no one can actually define whether you'll connect, and that is really...
You know, and you don't even know when that final yes letter will come. It will come. It will come. I remember when I had already gone through about 40 odd rejections, there is this a family friend of ours, he's a Punjabi gentleman, and he used to come very often once a week to our house. And he would sit down and have a whiskey with my father. And I know Gujarat is dry, but I can talk about whiskey, right?
Absolutely. They would love it by all means.
So, I mean, and of course, we all know that Gujarat isn't really dry. You can get the best of poison wherever you want.
You should know the right people.
But anyway, having said that, he used to come and have a whiskey with my father. Johnny Walker Black Label was their preferred poison. And they used to have patiala pegs. You know what a patiala peg is? Patiala peg means three fingers, but not like this, but like this. So that's a patiala peg. So they used to sit and have patiala pegs. And so this gentleman, he looked at me and he said, beta, kya ho gaya hai? Why are you so depressed? So I said, uncle, I have applied to the whole world. And rejection pe rejection aate ja raha hai. So he said, what's your problem, ya? Apply to a few more. So I said, but there is no one left on the list to apply to. So he said, beta, remember one thing. 99% in life is about good luck. And I was that day in an argumentative mood. So I said, but uncle, what about the 1%? That 1% must be hard work. It must be efficiency. It must be talent. It must be something else. He said, that 1%, and he picked up his glass. And he said, that 1% is known as bloody good luck. So, that is where, in fact, the series was born. 13 Steps to Bloody Good Luck. But the point I'm making is that everyone will eventually have that 1% bloody good luck coming in at some point of time. You need to be patient and wait for it to come.
Thank you. That's... Okay, so my next question to you is, what inspires, where do you get the inspiration for the relationships that your central protagonists have with others? So you really love the shade gray,
yeah.
It's been mentioned. So why don't you talk about the relationships, pick one book or pick all of them. So where do they get their relationships from here?
See, my approach to most of these books has always been that if you cannot keep the balls up in the air,
mm-hmm.
then you don't have a story. So it's like a juggler juggling several balls up in the air. And most important, conflict. So typically the first one third of your book should actually create, set the environment for a conflict. Mm-hmm. The next one third of your book should explain what the conflict is and take it to a crescendo. And the last one third is for that conflict to be resolved. So if you'll find in most of my books, the characters are fighting one another. Because, I mean, the whole point of a good story is conflict. Even if you're talking about a love story, if there isn't conflict, then what sort of a love story is, is it? So that is very much the case. You talked about grey characters. Yes, all of my books have revolved around grey characters because that's the way all of us are. You know, we are not all good and not all bad.
Absolutely.
There is shades of grey in everyone. And so what I like to do is have a character where at the end of the book you're wondering, was this guy a hero or was he a villain? And so, for example, with the Sialkot saga, I have people sort of coming back to me and saying, oh, because the two central characters are Arbaz and Arvind. So they say, "Arey, I thought that Arbaz is the nice guy. And I didn't really care for Arvind's character." And then there are people who will say, no, Arvind, he's the really the sweet guy. Arbaz, underworld thug. So everyone has a different opinion, and that's what makes the story that much more interesting.
So Ashwin, personally, when was it in life
I'll do.
You thought, so according to you, there's not much of black and white, but all of us are grey. When did Ashwin understand that we all are shades of grey? If you can think of anecdote, episode, or something that you read or you saw at each point in life.
Best way of experience. And sometimes, in fact, the shade of black or the shade of grey in you can also be a shade of white or vice versa. But you may have not understood it to be as much. Let me give you an example. I remember one of the earliest press conferences that I did. Someone asked me, they said, you are a Marwadi Banya and have grown up doing your Banyagiri, studied for this profession as a Banya, went for a BA, but that too in economics, did an MBA, but did your MBA in finance. And then suddenly one fine day, you become this bestseller writer. And suddenly we are expected to believe that you actually have the required qualifications to be doing what you do. So I said, frankly, I don't have the qualifications. But I said, when I was growing up, my mother always used to tell me that I was a damn good liar. She would say ki tum aise jhoot bolte ho ki matlab pata nahi chalta hai jab tum jhoot bol rahe ho.
And that really came handy, didn't it?
I realized to myself, I said, if I now think back, that one quality in me which allows me to spin my stories is the ability to lie. Because ultimately, as fiction writers, we are liars. We are building stories out of thin air. But then there is also the old proverb which says that if you must tell a lie, tell that lie as close to the truth as possible.
That is why the research.
Because if you tell that lie close to the truth, then it sounds that much more believable. So that's the reason you need to do research. So in case, for example, if you are explaining how an aircraft is crashing, you know that this air crash did not happen. But on the other hand, if you make that scene very, very realistic in terms of what would be the normal standard operating procedures that pilot would go through in order to prevent that crash, what would the passengers be feeling when that crash is happening, then it becomes believable. So it's a lie, but it becomes a believable lie. So the way I like to think about it is, all of us have qualities in us. Sometimes we think that they are negative qualities, but sometimes they play out in a different way.
Thank you, that was really interesting. So I read in Chanakya's Chant this one line which really fascinated me, and anyone can know the facts, but it's an art to have an opinion. So explain that, where does that come from?
It comes from the thought process that ultimately you can, I mean, I remember going through this when I was writing the Rosabal line. And a lot of people would ask, come back and ask me, they would say, you know, what is your view on this story? And unlike a lot of other authors who would say, well, you know, I mean, I don't have a view. Read the story and make up your mind. I would actually give them a definite point of view. So the way I like to think about it is that what is the harm in having a definite point of view and expressing it? That doesn't imply that my having a point of view makes your point of view any less than mine. They are just simply two points of view. But I genuinely believe that it's important for us to get our point of view across. So you'll genuinely find that in most of my books, some of my internal workings, there are many people who say, "Arey, why don't you write columns? Why don't you do this?" I said, just read my books. You'll find that all my thoughts and all my so-called points of view are right there.
So games people play, that's something which is very, very central to everything that you write, isn't it?
Yeah, because I think partly having a, you know, I remember reading Lao Tzu, and in that, or Sun Tzu, in that there was that famous book of his, The Art of War, and in that he wrote that politics is war without bloodshed. Right? So essentially, when you look at war and you look at politics, they're pretty much the same thing. The only difference is that in old times, if you needed to settle a political dispute, what you did was you took chariots, you took elephants, you took an army, and then you met it out on the battlefield
and decided
who wins. Today you topple the government, or you have a vote of no confidence, or you have a cash for vote scam, or something or the other. And essentially, but it's war. So the nature of conflict, the nature of gameplay has not changed in so many years. And that was the point of Chanakya's chant, to say that, okay, the environment may have changed, the props that we use may have changed, but human nature has not changed and will not change.
So this, like you say, the Marwari Paniya in your DNA, do you think the games people play also somehow comes from?
Of course it does. I remember when I had just written Chanakya's chant, I remember, and this is a slightly humorous story, my mother was one of the people who read it maybe a week or 10 days after the book came out. And after she finished reading the book, I noticed that for almost about a week or so, she was very distant from me. You know, I mean, I would say good morning and she would say good morning, but then no further conversation. So eventually I had to take the bull by the horns, and don't get me wrong, I'm not calling my mother a bull. I'm just saying that I took the matter in my own hands, and I went up to her and I said, "Ki, what is the problem? I mean, why are you so distant?" And she said, "I've read this book of yours and you have such a devious mind. You have an evil mind." So she said, "I'm actually worried about you." So the point I'm making is that to a very great extent, we grow up with experiences all around us. And if you have grown up in a typical Marwari business family, then, and why only Marwari business? I would say any business situation, any political situation. And I must tell you now, having been in the literary world for the last 12 years, I know that the politics that goes on in the world of literary pursuits is far more vicious than it is in the world of business or in the world of politics.
So games everywhere.
So somewhere along the way, we like reading about that sort of stuff because it's what is called delicious. It's very swadished. So that's what we do.
Lovely. Okay, talking about, moving on to something completely different and sure. Working with James Patterson.
Yeah.
How was the experience? How much did he put in? What did you, I mean, how do two people work together?
You know, with James, the amazing thing is that the books follow a three-step rule. All books of James Patterson. Step one, the first paragraph of the book must suck in the reader. It's like a pothole on the street. Once you've fallen in, it will take a long time for you to come out. Yeah? So, that is the first step in a James Patterson book. In fact, if you think about it, 90% out of the 100% James Patterson books, 90% he will put a corpse in the first paragraph. A dead body is needed in the first paragraph.
Very so, specific?
Yeah, yeah. So, that is step one. Step two, every chapter cannot be more than 1,000 words. The idea being because we are living in a world of declining attention spans. So in the human attention span, it's very interesting to note that if you had measured the human attention span in the year 2003, the human attention span was 12 seconds. Today, in 2013, not 2016, 2013, the attention span of a human being is 8 seconds, which means that there has been a 33% decline in a matter of 10 years. This also is very scary because if you consider the attention span of a goldfish, it is 9 seconds, which means that we writers are better off writing for goldfish than human beings. But anyway, having said that, so the chapters need to be short so that you can keep a person's attention, and the chapter has to end with a hook so that it propels you. You should not have the option of deciding, should I go to the next chapter? You have to be pushed into the next chapter. And finally, the last paragraph of the book should leave you with a sense of contentment, but more importantly, it should force your reader to look out for your next book. Because that is ultimately what a bestseller is all about. Now, if you can do all of those three things, then you have the perfect crime thriller, a la Ashwin, Sanghi and James Patterson. So, with James, as long as you follow that pattern, everything else goes. He is one of the most open guys to work with. As far as the India stories are concerned, the way it works is typically that I will start with a plot outline. The plot outline is very detailed. So for example, a book which is by Ashwin Sanghi and James Patterson will typically run 70,000 or 75,000 words, but the plot outline itself will run 10,000 words. So every twist, every turn, every development has been plotted out in advance. The advantage of that is that it gives both authors a very clear map. And so even if they are starting from different points, they know exactly how to get to the destination. So that is very important. Then the second part of it is once we have both agreed on the plot outline, then we divide up what are the areas which I am better writing and what are the areas which he is better writing. So for example, I am very good when it comes down to, for example, creating suspense. But when it comes down to all-out violence, James is the king of it. If there are multiple people and there's lots of blood on the floor, he becomes almost like, he comes into his own. The same applies with, for example, with me, if I'm sort of talking about a man and a woman in a hotel room, I'll say, well, they took off their clothes and they made love. Whereas with James Patterson, he will become very graphic. So I always prefer to leave those scenes to him. Because there is nothing like anything holding him back.
How does the language blend in of two people
so
with two different contexts?
Once he has written something and once I've written something, he gives me the stuff he wrote and I give him the stuff that I wrote. Which means, in other words, that we get a chance to actually work on each other's writing. And then eventually it goes into a guy who is known as the commissioning editor. Not the commissioning editor, but actually I would prefer to call him or her the stitching editor. They stitch together what he has written and what I have written. So it's a relatively complicated process, but it tends to work.
Fantastic. One last question before we open it to the floor.
Sure.
3 steps to bloody good luck and 13 steps to bloody good luck and 13.
But I would love to do a 3 also.
Wow. Let's talk about one thing in the bloody good luck. First of all, the word bloody. That's so interesting. How did that happen?
I told you the story.
Yeah. Okay.
So at that time itself,
bloody good luck.
I had thought to myself ki I will write a book on bloody good luck. Okay. But how did that actually, that first book emerge? I was actually at a lit fest, like the one that I'm attending right now.
Jaipur.
It was Chennai.
Okay.
I gave this story about this Punjabi friend who said 1% bloody good luck. And there was this young lady in the audience and she followed me outside. And she said, sir, but if 99% is good luck and 1% is bloody good luck, then in that case, why should I work? I may as well just sit and do nothing. I'll watch TV all day. So I thought about what she was saying. My publisher was standing next to me. And he said, Ashwin, you need to write a book explaining to this young lady as to what does that 1% bloody good luck actually mean. And that's how the idea for that book was born. Now, once that book came out, then the thought arose that, well, a young student wrote to me. He said, you know, I've read this book, but I would love to have a book about how I can study better. Are there 13 steps to acing my exams? And I thought to myself, I said, there are so many people who want various subjects to be demystified. So that's how we ended up writing 13 Steps to Bloody Good Wealth. The next book in the series is 13 Steps to Bloody Good Marks. There is another book in the series which is 13 Steps to Bloody Good Parenting. There is a book on 13 Steps to Bloody Good Communication, and so on and so forth. So the intention is eventually that we will try and demystify different topics.
Would you like to talk about one out of 13 steps to wealth creation? Any one quickly?
Well, you know, and this is not just for wealth, but it's also for the luck bit. In fact, it's a common factor which arises, and that is simply the power of patience. There is something which is called patience, where you just simply have to wait for your time to come. In the wealth book, I talk about this young man called Muhammad Anwar, who was in a small village in Maharashtra. And one day he was at a tea shop and a man came along and he was asking questions about a factory that was located close by. And Muhammad Anwar helped him with a few answers. Then he was actually a stockbroker who had come there. So the stockbroker said that, listen, I'm interested in buying shares of that company. So can you introduce me to other people in this neighborhood who might be holding shares? So this Muhammad took this broker to various people and they acquired some 1,000 odd shares for the broker. But along the way, Muhammad understood that a share is a fractional ownership of that company. So he decided to pick up 100 shares for his own account. His father had just died. There was a plot of land and it had been divided up. The amount which came was some 80,000 rupees. It was divided across 4 brothers. So 20,000 came to each brother. So Muhammad took 10,000 of that and put it into shares, 100 shares of this company. Now this was in somewhere around the early 1980s. Now he did not touch those shares for the next 25 years. In fact, sorry, next 30 odd years. The shares kept on receiving dividends. They kept on getting split. There were bonus shares issued on the same shares. But long and short is, between the bonus shares, the change in the valuation of those shares, as well as the dividends declared, at the end of 2015, he had made 612 crores. From 10,000 rupees, and they were 100 shares of Wipro, by the way.
Okay.
Which at that time was just a vegetable oil and vanaspati manufacturer. Now the point I'm making is that if you cannot be patient, there is no way that your good luck or the so-called good wealth can play out. If you own junk, it doesn't make sense to be patient. So, I mean, junk is going to be junk even 30 years later. But assuming that you have made your investment wisely, you need to be patient.
Thank you so much. Thanks. Was so interesting. So shall we open the floor for questions and answer questions, please? Okay, so sure. We have someone there.
Good afternoon, sir.
Afternoon.
You have talked about lying as close to the truth as possible. And in Sialgod Saga, I read that that bit was developed to its fullest because you have not giving away much of the plot, but you have intermingled the fictitious events that you have created along with the actual historical events that took place.
Thank you.
That makes the book all the more interesting. So what extra bit of research did it go into that, making that book possible?
You know, frankly, the bit that I love about writing these sort of books is actually the research process. In fact, I feel rather bad when that research process ends because it means that actually my exploration into that subject has also ended. But since you specifically spoke about the Sialkot saga, how it actually started was that, by the way, for those of you who don't know, there is one more Baniya trait in me, and which is that I write all my plots on Excel spreadsheets. So it starts with an Excel spreadsheet. So the Excel spreadsheet, now visualize for a minute that you have an Excel spreadsheet in which the first column is the year. As you know, Sialkot saga starts in 1947, ends in 2010. So there's about 63 odd years. So imagine that every year from 1947 all the way through till 2010 has been plotted in that first column. The second two columns are the ages of Arvind and Arbaaz. So what was the age of Arvind in 1947? What was it in 2000? What was it in 1995? And similarly for Arbaaz. Then the next column describes what those two characters should have been doing at those ages. So for example, if someone was, let's say, aged 7, you would not be expecting him to set up a business empire. Instead, probably he would be struggling with homework. On the other hand, in case someone is probably 18 or 20 or 25, then probably he would be figuring out how can he get his first kiss. In case he is 30 or 35, he would be dealing with the challenges of politics, business, life in general. So what exactly was happening in those lives during that year is what I plotted next. And then the last column was in terms of what was happening in India at that time. So was it, let's say the death of Sardar Patel? Or for example, was it that there was a language agitation going on? And of course, one more column is in terms of what were the cultural aspects of India at that time. So for example, you can pick up about Sardar Patel from any historical book. But for example, if you're talking about someone who lived in Calcutta and in, let's say at age 18, he was taking his girlfriend out for dinner, then which was the place that he would have taken her to? Because which restaurants were popular at that time? Or if you went with your friend in order to have puchka pani somewhere, then what was the cost of a puchka? I mean, those are the elements which make that story believable. So all of that had to be plotted into this one gigantic spreadsheet. And it was only when I had completed that, that I actually started writing the book. So, thank you.
Good afternoon, sir.
Whoever wants to ask a question, please make sure that you get the mic. I'm sorry, it's whoever has the mic. Carry on, please.
Good afternoon, sir. Kanchet Yadav here, big fan of yours.
Thank you.
Since, sir, you are involved in mythological fiction, I wanted to ask if there are any plans to write about Lord Shiva or for that matter.
My friend Avish Tripathi has already done Shiva so much, yeah. Now, how many more books can we do on Shiva?
Sir, sort of thriller.
Yeah. Well, you know, I must tell you, the one character that genuinely does, for those who read the Sialkot saga, some of that fascination comes through, is Hanuman. And so at some point of time, maybe I might really look at doing a book dedicated to Hanuman. But which in a certain sense automatically implies that I'm also covering Shivji in some way. Sorry, who has the mic? Chirantana.
Okay, so, you know, of course, we all know that you are from a business family, and of course, your interest in business is very clear. But as a writer, what tempts you more, history or politics? Because you can't separate them.
Yeah.
And in today's time, since last maybe a few years or as we have grown up, you know, there are a lot of sensitive issues also.
Yeah.
So when you write, how do you take care of, you know, keeping away from sensationalized stuff?
Yeah.
And your interest towards history and politics goals?
Okay. Frankly, I must tell you the you know, I think it was, I can't remember who it was who said that politics is actually made up of two words, poly and tics. Poly means many in Latin, and tics means blood-sucking creatures. Huh? So it's that combination of those two words. But that's what makes politics so interesting. So I found that as one area of exploration. The other part of it is history in general. I think as the lady who introduced us said, that I have always genuinely believed that history is a pack of lies written about events that never happened and written by people who were never there. So to that extent, I believe that you have to take history with a pinch of salt. In fact, not a pinch of salt, but a sack full of salt. The other part of it is mythology. And to a certain extent, I sometimes feel that mythology is more honest than history. Because at least you know that you are reading a fantastical tale. Think about it this way, that we started out with 25,000 verses of the Jaya. We went into 50,000 verses of the Bharat, and we went to 100,000 verses of the Mahabharat. The truth is that every writer, even though we would like to call all those writers Rishi Vyas, but Rishi Vyas would have had to live for a bloody long time to go from 25,000 to 100,000. But having said that, each one would have added their own mirch masala to the story. The same applies, let's say, even with the Ramayana. You read the Tulsi Ramayana versus the Valmiki Ramayana versus the Adbhut Ramayana versus so many 300 other versions of the Ramayana. All of them have a different tale to tell. Which means, in other words, that we were always open to the idea that your truth doesn't have to be any less than my truth. That all of our truths are almost in a parallel universe. What's important is not the story, but the central context. I think it was the great C.S. Lewis who said that a myth is a lie that contains a truth. So look for that truth which is contained in the myth. Now, when I think about it, people, I mean, I'm glad you actually asked me that question, that what is it that actually fascinates you? Is it history? Is it mythology? Is it politics? Is it business? Well, yes, there are many things that interest me, but what fascinates me the most is probably the overlap between myth and history. So if I can, I'm assuming everyone out here has done basic mathematics and would have done Venn diagrams. So in a Venn diagram, visualize two circles. One is mythology and one is history. And bring the two circles together and they overlap. And in that overlaps zone, you have the overlap between myth and history. And now just think about it. When you bring two words like myth and history together, what is the word that you should get? Mystery. So that's pretty much what I do. Whoever has the mic, please speak.
Hello,
please.
Hello.
Hi.
Since you are from a business family,
yeah.
So how do you find in terms of book writing? Is it a profitable business?
Now this is a question that I was waiting for. Because you can't come to Ahmedabad and not have this question. So I must tell you, you know, I started working for my father when I was 12. Even during school days, I used to go to our place of work, and we used to have a Marwadi Munimji who used to wear a kala topi and used to wear a dhoti, and he used to teach me how to write what was in those days known as the bahi khata. So I grew up learning that. And the other part of it was my grandfather. My grandfather, not my dadaji, but my nanaji. My nanaji lived in Kanpur and was a wealthy businessman of Kanpur. But more importantly, he loved reading and writing. So he had this huge library, and in that library, he had some 8,000-10,000 books. And he would very lovingly pick out one book and send it to me every week. Ki beta, isko padho, isme se tumko kuch gyan milega. And so during his lifetime, I received more than 400 books from him, starting from that age of 12 or 13. Now, I would go to my office, my father's office, and Munimji would see that I am carrying that book. So he would tell me, he would say, beta, why are you wasting your time? Bookkeeping is more important than book reading. And he would say, if you must read, then read a balance sheet. Why are you reading this? So that was the cultural context in which I grew up. But the important thing is that when I would go back to my Nanaji and I would ask him, I would say, this is what my Munimji is saying. He's saying that I'm wasting my time reading the books that you're giving me. So he would say that, beta, remember one thing, that without Saraswati, Lakshmi is of no use. So I couldn't understand exactly what he was saying. So then he told me the story. He said ki Lakshmi is always very jealous of Saraswati. So Lakshmi is always looking around ki where has Saraswati gone? And if Saraswati has gone there, then let me follow her and let me sit there also. So, and of course, Saraswati gets very irritated. So because she gets irritated, whenever Lakshmi comes there, hum log ki buddhi brush ho jati hai na. Saraswati chale jati hai uska. So, he said, you have to understand this. He said, it's very difficult to get both Lakshmi and Saraswati to sit together. So he said, there is only one person who can get the two of them to sit together, and that is Ganesh ji. Which probably explains why Ashwin Sanghi's physique is the way it is. So, I have tried through my life to keep Lakshmi and Saraswati on either side. Has it actually been a profitable process? Well, first few years, no. And that's why for young authors, I tell them that, listen, don't leave your job when you are starting out as a writer. Find the additional time that is needed to take up your writing, but don't give up your day job. Because ultimately, at the end of the day, you have responsibilities to feed yourself, your family, and so on and so forth. Then, at some point of time, your royalties, and this happens to a very small percentage of writers, at some point, your royalties will be significant enough for you to be able to probably enjoy that little extra luxury in life beyond what you are earning. And at the final stage, once you have reached where you know that, okay, my daily expenses can be met from my royalty, from the income that I'm making, that's the time that you can become a full-time writer. So I would say that if you really think about it, probably less than 1% of writers in this country are actually at that level where our royalties are, you know, able to meet. I'm one of the lucky ones who is at that level. But then again, so a lot of people ask me, why don't you give up work now? Your royalties are good enough. If you want, you can live on your royalties. And I say, look, you know, I mean, I go 5 days a week still to my place of work in good old Banya fashion. I go there because why? Because my 78-year-old father feels that my beta is still there. He still comes into the office, so he feels very happy when he sees me. Because when I had first decided to become a writer, I think my father had nightmares. He managed to MBA vagera pe kharcha kiya, and he ab khadi ka kurta aur chola leke kahin na kahin bhatkega. So he was worried. And so he feels happy when he sees me there. And then secondly, more important, when people ask me why, I say, well, you know, I also need to protect my inheritance. So if I don't protect my inheritance, then who will? So that's the reason I still go into work. But yes, 10 years ago, I was a businessman who was also a writer. Now I'm a writer who's also a businessman.
I think we have time for one last question.
Hi. Finally, you got the mic.
Finally. So that's bloody good luck, as we would say. So I had this question.
Sure.
Those who have the gold have the power.
Yeah.
It is quoted in your book, the Sialkot Saga.
Yep. And
how relevant is the context? How is it relevant in the present context? And what are your views on it? And how can democracy come into play when all the powers are lying in the hands of the rich? So that's my question.
Okay, this is the sort of question that I should actually be answering in the evening after I've had three pegs of whiskey. But anyway, I will try and answer it in a completely sober condition. The line that was quoted in the book was that the golden rule is that those who have the gold make the rule. And what it basically implies is that rich people have the ability to be able to fashion the rules according to their financial clout and muscle. And this is not something new. Wo janam janmantar se aa raha hai. Purane zamane mein maharaja log used to make the rules. They are the ones who had the riches also, and they are the ones who used to make the rules also. In later years, when we became a colonial rule country, it was the colonial rulers who had most of the wealth concentrated in their hands, and they were the ones who also made the rules. Today, you basically, when you look across the world, whether it is the US or India or any of the capitalist democracies, you find that there is again a significant concentration of economic power, and by virtue of that economic power, they are able to at times actually get the rules bent to the way they want. I mean, see the rise of Donald Trump in the US. To a very great extent, I believe that it is probably what every wealthy person would have wanted, because I think he's going to be extremely proactive in terms of reducing taxes on the rich. Similarly, for example, if we see India, we see the entire game of the golden rule playing out before our very eyes with demonetization. I mean, all those guys who were sitting on cash must have been wondering, why was I not sitting on gold? So I think the very nature of democracy is that it allows everyone to vote, but not every vote tends to be equal. And it is possible to actually influence the outcome in ways that we don't care to imagine. Is it perfect? No. But then, you know, it was, I think, the great Winston Churchill who said, democracy is the worst system in the world after every other system that has been tried. So the truth is that would you rather be in something like communism or socialism or fascism or what have you? So to that extent, with all its ills, I think democracy is probably one of the few guiding lights. And I think when people from outside look at our country, they say, okay, with all the problems that India has, with all the difficulties, with all the grinding poverty, at least this is a country where there has been a tremendous separation of power between the civilian and the military branches. And you haven't had situations like military coups. You haven't had a situation where one element, except for that brief period of 2 years of emergency, but otherwise, by and large, democracy has worked. So I think we need to count our blessings and be grateful for that.
It was the last question, but sir, here.
Alright, I guess you can take
I'll take the double bloody good luck. Okay, I have read, sir, all the three of your books. And like everybody else, I would not get that cliche, I'm a diehard fan, but I love these books. And I'm a diehard George R.R. Martin fan. Sir, I have even tried to read Mahabharata itself.
Okay.
So, I compared it with GOT. I mean, that's somewhere.
Yes.
What I felt was that in the subconscious Indian mind, we always see our characters as either anti-hero or hero. There's no in between, right? It's either black or white. There are no colors of emotions.
Correct.
When we see GOT, there's no villain, there's no hero. Everybody is colorful. Nobody is black or white.
Correct.
Sir, can I expect it from you to write something about the Mahabharata in that context? Nobody is black, nobody is white. Show the colors of emotion.
Okay, it's a good question. I must tell you, there are already several authors who, I must also tell you that I'm also a Game of Thrones fan. So to that extent, that's a series that I love. Over a period of time, of course, it started becoming a little predictable because every character that I loved tended to die. So I have found that there are some authors in the Indian space who have actually told a different point of view. So for example, my friend Anand Neelkanthan has done a terrific job on telling the story of Ravan as well as on telling the story of Duryodhan. And I found those books really incredibly enlightening, because there's that old proverb which says that history is written by the victors. So what we are actually hearing is only one version of events. So I love the fact that it is possible to give a different dimension to even those people who we consider as villains in history. On the other hand, from my perspective, I have always in my own ways tried to make sure that my characters are multidimensional, that they don't necessarily follow one pattern or the other. You can have a good guy, but under the so-called correct circumstances, may end up doing a heinous murder. And on the other hand, you could have a murderer who, given the right circumstances, could actually help someone else. So I love that, because that's the way human nature is. Will I ever attempt to do something which is in the order of Game of Thrones? I don't know. The problem I have is that I tend to get bored rather easily. Like the human attention span, my attention span is also limited. So for example, if I've done a book on Roosevelt and Jesus Christ, I don't see myself writing a sequel to that. But then I move on to Chanakya. And if I've done Chanakya, then I move on to Krishna. So for me, every book becomes a new exploration. And that's really where the problem arises. Because for a series such as Game of Thrones, you need to be able to live with that story for 10 years or more. That's really where I admire guys like Amish, who've been able to live with one story over several books. I know how difficult it is.
You could probably try Iravati Karve. She's done a very nice analysis of the Mahabharata character. So it's a small read, but very interesting.
I think one part of your question was also related to the Mahabharata itself, that would you attempt something in that space? I believe that the Mahabharata can be attempted n number of times and we will still not get tired. Because with every reading, we will explore elements that are waiting to be explored. In fact, if you have read the Krishna Ki, my effort was to actually present to you the Mahabharata in 108 paragraphs, which was my starting point. maybe at some point of time in the future, I might actually look at expanding that and taking that forward, but not in the immediate future.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ashwin.
Thank you, Raksha. Thank you so much.
Thank you, great audience. It's great to have all of you.
Before I conclude the session, Ashwin, I had heard you at IIM last year. And that time I got to know that, how do you write? There was a whole PPT and whole business format with you in suit and everything. But today, thanks to Raksha, this was quite an unraveling session at the Gujarat Literature Festival. And I got to know, how do you write and why do you write? So thank you so much. And I hope you all also had a good time. A session filled with a lot of learnings. And all those interesting questions were answered. Thank you, Raksha. And thank you, Ashwin, once again. We have another session coming up over here at 3:30. And I would request you all to please stay back for that. We have Johi Chaturvedi, Soumya Joshi, Jaydeep Sahani over here coming up for the next session. Apart from that, a lot of other interesting sessions are going on at different places. One second.
There's this young fan of mine. His name is Vishwes Desai. And he has just presented me with this book. So please do pick up a copy. It's called Shadows of the Northlands. So good luck to Vishwes.
Well, another session at 3:30 at Diamond Mine is going to start, Living Roots of Grassroots by Professor Aril Gupta, where he will be in conversation with Paras Jha. I would request you all to please be there as well. Before we conclude and start the next session, I would also would like to thank our patron, Reliance Industries Limited, our main sponsors, Jagriti Group and Adani. Also, our sponsors for Gujarat Literature Festival, KHS, Zydus, Gujarat Sahitya Academy, Karma Foundation, Navjeevan, Heath Graphics, Pujan Decor, and Creative Yatra. Also, we are also immensely thankful to our friends of literature, IntelliMedia, Simulations Public Affairs Limited, Linguistic, Dew School, NASCO, Akriti, Sparsh, the House of MG, AB Jewels, Cineman, and we have a couple of friends more. We have Matru Bhasha Abhyan with us and Gurjar Bharti. Thank you so much once again, along with Ahmedabad Book Club, for helping us to make this event a successful one. I'll see you at other session. Thank you so much. Your host for the session, Lippi Goyal. Good afternoon. અભી કેવી ચર્ચા થવા જઈ રહી છે જે મને એવું લાગે છે કે ક્યાંક ને ક્યાંક આપણા બધાના મનમાં ચાલતી જ હોય છે ફિલ્મો વિશેની ખૂબ જ રસપ્રદ ચર્ચા ફિલ્મો અને એની ભાષા જેટલા પણ લોકો તમારા મિત્રો અહીંયા આપણી સાથે આ સેશન અટેન્ડ કરવા આવ્યા હોય તો પ્લીઝ કોલ ધેમ ટુ ધીસ વેન્યુ ધીસ ઇઝ કોલ્ડ સેપ્ટ પ્લાઝા આપણી પાસે 5-6 મિનિટનો સમય છે તો પ્લીઝ તમારા બધા જ મિત્રોને બોલાવી લેજો એન્ડ આઈ વુડ રિક્વેસ્ટ ઓલ ધ ગેસ્ટ જે પાછળ ઊભા છે કે પ્લીઝ તમારી જગ્યા લઈ લો